I built this microphone for less than $76 in parts. In a few minutes, we'll hear whether that was money well spent or another terrible life choice. When I was reviewing the $25 microphone in my last video, it surprised me how good the quality was for that price. And like any completely sane person, I had the knee-jerk reaction to start wondering how hard it would be to make a studio-worthy microphone myself. When I googled around a little bit, I stumbled upon these readily available DIY microphone kits, but at the price they cost, you can just buy a high-quality microphone and be done with it. So that seems kind of pointless. Thinking those DIY microphone retailers charge quite a bit of markup, I went looking if there were cheaper ways to source microphone parts. And then I noticed that the capsules used in some of these DIY microphone builds are also available on AliExpress. And not only capsules are available there, but all kinds of microphone parts. And often way cheaper. Now, AliExpress can be a bit hit or miss a lot of the time. Some of the things you can buy there are okay quality and others are real junk and knockoffs. We can look at the reviews of products, but even then it can still be quite a gamble. Nonetheless, with the price difference, I decided I still wanted to at least attempt building a mic with parts sourced there. So I had a look at what we need to start building a microphone. First of all, we need a capsule. The capsule is the part that actually converts sound waves into an electrical signal, and it's one of the biggest factors in how a microphone ends up sounding. Now, I'm going to get a bit technical for a minute, bear with me. I'm aiming to build a mic that can pick up fine details, so I didn't want to use a dynamic capsule used by mics like the SM58. Instead, I wanted to use a condenser capsule, which is generally more sensitive and captures more detail. But within condenser capsules, there are still two main types to choose from. Externally polarized capsules, often called true condenser capsules, and electret capsules. Both types work in the same basic way. A very thin membrane moves when sound hits it, and those tiny movements are converted into an electrical signal. This happens because the capsule acts like some kind of capacitor, which changes in capacitance when the sound waves hit the diaphragm. However, the microphone electronics can only sense this capacitance change if the condenser capsule is charged. There are two different ways to apply this electrical charge. The first is to use an external voltage, which is what true condensers do. The second is to create a permanent electric charge in the capsule itself, and this is done by applying a special substance called electret. And this is why these are called electret capsules. True condenser capsules are often preferred in studio microphones. This is because they usually have better sensitivity and they tend to capture subtle details a bit better. There is also a better consistency between microphones. Electret capsules are often cheaper and the internal charge of some electrets can weaken over decades, which increases the noise and reduces the output. That being said, that doesn't mean electrets are bad. Modern electrets often are built way better and don't suffer from a weakening internal charge as much. Some can even sound quite excellent and they are often used in studio microphones as well. In fact, the $25 studio microphone from my previous video also used an electret capsule. But don't let that make you think that they are only used in budget mics. Some expensive microphones use them as well. One downside is that the electronics for a true condenser mic are often a bit more complex, so I won't be able to just slap a resistor and a capacitor on it and call it a day. Nonetheless, I decided to go with a true condenser build anyway, because that just seemed like the obvious choice for a quality microphone. I let other DIY microphone builds inspire me a bit, and those sometimes use the RK87 as a capsule. That capsule is inspired by the Neumann K87 capsule design, which is a high quality capsule used in the Neumann U87, a vintage studio microphone that costs thousands of dollars. Such an RK87 capsule is available on AliExpress for $18.55, so that seems pretty reasonable. But we can't just have a capsule like this sitting out in the open though, because they are quite easily damaged. Also, the wires from the capsule can often act like antennas. To tackle both those issues, we can put everything in an all-metal enclosure that acts like a Faraday cage. Luckily, you can also find a couple of those on AliExpress. But next to that, we'll also need some electronics that both power the capsule and convert the signals from capsule to mic level, so we can use it with professional equipment. I don't know nearly enough about electronics to start designing my own circuit for this, so I was hoping I could find something ready-made. Luckily, I found both a circuit and a mic body that should fit together. This mic body has a nice price and looks a bit like a TLM-103. I'm not trying to make a clone or anything here, but it does look like a nice mic body and one of the comments said it's all metal, so that should be good. It's important to verify that on AliExpress, of course. They could be shipping out silver painted plastic junk as well. I also found a circuit that could fit in this body. The good thing is that it already has an XLR connector attached to it as well, and it had one review saying there was almost no noise. While that single review didn't give me a lot of confidence yet, I decided to give it a try. In the worst case, I could try another one. A couple of weeks later, my package from China arrived. I first wanted to test if you could actually get any sound out of her parts. So I first took the capsule, which I had to handle very carefully. I didn't want to have to order another one. The box it comes in is a bit hard to open, so I carefully tried to force it open. Once it was out, I started by attaching the small cable to the first backplate. This capsule has two diaphragms, which allows for different polar patterns if the circuit supports it. But I just wanted to do a cardioid pattern, which means the mic picks up sound from the front. And for that, we only need to wire up the front of the capsule. Using tools so close to such a fragile component always feels a bit risky, because my hands are playing in constant vibrato. Once that was screwed in, I took our little circuit board and pulled apart the two leads that are supposed to go to the microphone. These are supposed to be removed eventually, because it's not advised to change the ones that are already on the capsule. Since I was just testing at this point, I wasn't soldering yet, and I just attached the capsule and circuit board wires to each other with some waggles. And that was actually quite finicky with these small wires. Time to plug it into my audio interface to see if there's some sound coming out. I was kind of worried, because the meter on my audio interface just went straight up, so I listened on my computer to the signal coming from the mic.
Hello, hello, hello. So we're getting some sound, but we're also getting a lot of feedback.
Alright, so that was quite a bit of feedback, and it seemed to get worse when I held the capsule close to the desk. I suppose this was due to interference or the capsule not being properly shielded yet, but I wasn't sure. So I hope nothing was actually broken, but we could hear my voice in the recording, so I wasn't going to give up just yet, and I hope that putting everything in the microphone body would fix it. I first disconnected the leads from the circuit board using my soldering iron. Once that was done, the wires from the capsule could be attached. My hands weren't shaky, the surroundings were vibrating. Then I removed the screw for the XLR connector from the board. I put the board in the microphone body and screwed the screw back in. This firmly attaches the board to the body. Next, we'll have to attach the saddle, which can hold the capsule. We can use the two small included screws to do so. Then I tried attaching the capsule to the saddle, but something was wrong. The holes on the capsule did not line up with the holes on the saddle. Luckily, the shape of the saddle was a perfect fit with the capsule, so I decided to superglue the capsule to the saddle instead. I know, it's not best practice. A true engineer would have used duct tape. Then I took the plate holding the capsule, put it on top of the body holding the circuit board, and screwed everything down. Then I finished it off by placing the basket on the body. But then, I hit the next problem. The pressure plugs that are used for attaching the basket are really, really tiny, and I didn't even have an Allen key this small. Luckily, I found a flat screwdriver that kind of fit in the hole and had a little bit of grip, so I used that to screw them in, which surprisingly worked. Now everything was solidly attached, so it's time to test the microphone.
Alright, so here we have the full mic. Let's test that out.
This is how the mic sounds. This is how the mic sounds. Oh yeah, this is the front, definitely. Hello, hello. Test, 1, 2, test. Check, check, 1, 2, check. Hello. Doesn't sound too bad, I guess.
The next few days I put the mic through its paces, and I did notice some issues. When the microphone is very close to my mobile phone, it can sometimes, although not very frequently, pick up GSM noise. It might be that the circuit board does not protect enough against that, but I'm not sure. If you have any ideas, please let me know in the comments. But as long as you keep some distance from your phone, this doesn't really have to be a problem. I also noticed that the vocals had a bit of a metallic sound sometimes. So I opened up the mic again, and I noticed that the plate below the saddle was not screwed on tight enough. So I increased the tension a little. This reduced the metallic ring, so definitely make sure that it's screwed on tightly if you attempt to do this yourself. I also added some open cell foam on top of that plate to dampen any sound waves that might hit it, but I'm not sure if that actually made any difference. Just for reference, let's compare this mic to my Lewitt LCT440 Pure now, which is quite a popular professional studio microphone. The custom mic needs just a little more gain on my audio interface to get the same volume as the Lewitt mic, but it's not a lot. With the extra gain applied, our custom mic seems to have less noise than the Luit mic, which is great, but that is mainly because of the high self-noise in the sub-region of the Luit. In the more audible region, the signal is a bit more noisy on our custom mic, but overall it's manageable for recording, and it shouldn't stop anyone from getting great recordings. Funny how the noise profiles of these mics can be so different. Here's some vocal clips that I recorded at the same time, with the two mics next to each other.
Check, check, 1, 2, 3, check. Check, check, 1, 2, 3, check. Test, test, test. Test, test, test. Hello, hello. Hello, hello. Check, check, 1, 2, 3, check. Check, check, 1, 2, 3, check. Hello, hello. Hello, hello.
Personally, apart from the tiny bit of self-noise, I think our custom mic doesn't really have to be second to the Luit. It's way better than I expected for a first attempt at building a microphone. I'm definitely not going to call it high-end, but what do you think? Is it studio-worthy? In total, I spent $75.92 on the parts for the microphone, $18.55 for the capsule, $28.99 for the circuit board, and $28.38 for the microphone body. I also bought a universal microphone shock mount for $5, and despite its bulky size, it works quite well. But it's all plastic, so I'm not sure how long it will last. I'll add a link to all the parts in the description of this video, in case you want to try this yourself. It's a cool little project and it takes less time than it took to make this video. So if you like this video, give it a thumbs up to boost the algorithm, and consider subscribing. Feel free to leave a comment as well, I will try to read all of them. Thanks for watching.